Welcome back, Zero K fans. Once again, Shadow Fury 63, this time with Floris.
Hello.
Yeah, Floris is joined back up. We have, as usual, two people now.
Yep, two. Which is more than you alone.
Yeah, so hopefully Sackdoth will be able to join up later, but Sackdoth is not currently here. However, Floris and I, that's still something. So we have, the next game is going to be on Iced Coffee, which is surprisingly used. I don't know why Anarchid used this map. It's really small. But, yeah, it's not a map I would have chosen. And I'm biased towards it.
It's your map. Maybe it's politics.
I don't know. I mean, personally, I think it's an okay map, and not great.
Yeah.
The only thing is, I like the use of the Trojan Hills style thing I did before, but frankly, it's my first map. Like, I don't really think it's that great. Certainly not as a 2v2 map. It's a 1v1 map, through and through.
Yeah, at most.
Although Anarchid pointing out that it's actually bigger than Frozen Planet, which I don't believe because this is an 8x8 map.
I'm pretty sure Frozen Planet is 8x8 too.
Yeah, that's generally the minimum, with a few joke exceptions. So I don't know, but I think it maybe just is more that the amount of playable area is larger, which it definitely is. There's more room to maneuver.
I think this map, the design is okay. I think it's pretty nice. It's just a little small. If you would scale it up a bit, it would work a bit better, I think. But
layout is great. I mean, when I first made it, I just didn't have... Well, I still don't have great tools for making larger maps, but I certainly didn't have much at the time. Anyway.
Let's see what they're discussing strategy-wise.
So it looks like...
We got Fred and Ivory King from GBC.
Yeah, and they're discussing going jump and cloaky from the looks of it. Oh, no. No, sorry. Manu and Julian are going cloaky and air, but we aren't hearing their discussion. They might be on Skype. And yeah, jump and cloaky is for Fred and Ivory King. And this is the start of the game. Fred and Ivory King to the south. Manu and Julian to the north. Manu and Julian, I've actually not seen, but apparently they are top players.
They are.
Wow. Okay.
Julian, I think I've seen him a couple times.
Any notes about his style or their style?
No, not really.
I see.
But just good understanding of the game.
That's good. So one thing to point out about this map is this is a map with... It does have this obvious ramp here, but there's actually two... There's sort of a ramp in the back. Bots can actually go around the back. In this little red area between the purple sections. That's actually bot pathable. So
it
there is a bit of a back door. But overall, this ramp is the main way you get out.
Now, you can see the GBC guys putting up race gears as soon as they saw the Swift. And the second airplane is a Raven. On this map, it's very common to see napalm bombers to bomb the windmills.
On the wind generators, yeah, because wind generators on this map, I mean, on the main area, they're actually not that powerful, 0.3 to 2.5, but they are popular.
But here is what you just told us about.
The back door being used quite nicely by Manu, getting rid of wind gen, getting rid of a metal extractor, probably going to get rid of this metal extractor over to the north too. Ivory King's commander coming to try to deal with that, and Manu wisely retreating, getting around, trying to see if they can get to the southern metal extractors, which have not been taken. But still,
yeah,
that glaive leaves unscathed. Nicely done. Oops. Wait, why is smoke on? Okay, I apparently have more widgets I need to turn off. Or default widgets that need to not be. I thought smoke signals was a bad thing. Anyway, that doesn't matter. Julian and Manu haven't really dealt that much damage, though. Fred and Ivory King, they have... I think the biggest damage dealt is that Fred and Ivory King really aren't moving out. I mean, Manu and Julian are dictating the pace of the match. Neither of the GBC players have moved out. They haven't expanded outside of their main base.
Exactly. They are hopelessly behind, economy-wise.
Yeah, the others up north and just completely taking the north. A little surprising that Julian hasn't taken the northeast, however. Manu's taken the northwest. Julian, however, I mean, I suppose they don't have any cranes or anything, so their commander is assisting. That kind of makes sense. But still, Raven's coming in, trying to get rid of the commanders. Not managing to do much damage, though. Getting forced away by gremlins, and... That's... Yeah, that's still pretty good. I mean, the thing is, I don't think Manu and Julian are betting on a win with the Napalm Bomb. I'm sorry, with the Ravens. I think they want one. I mean, if you can get a win with the Ravens, that's great. But I seriously think that they're just going to go for, it looks like late game units, try or mid late game.
Now the thing
Zeus
is,
or Rocco, try to win
that
way.
They do have a fair amount of AA bots, but
yeah, that's right.
If they want to come back, they have to take down a couple of those bombers without losing the commander.
And I don't.
The commander does have armor plates, so that's a good one. It will take, yeah, still three bombers to bomb.
Yep.
And I don't think this is a wise decision to move out with a commander like this.
Especially not the recon comment. Ivory King is...
They should be hunting bombers now.
Well, I think that's what they're trying to do, but the bombers are coming in. The bombers are going to be able to hit first.
No, it,
and down goes Ivory King's commander. That was a big loss.
At the cost of two bombers.
At the cost of two bombers, yes, that's true. Not as big of a loss then. They a bit amortized, but even then, the commander being pushed forward like that, that was... Probably, well, 250 metal or so, just in that commander. Not to mention the fact that the commander is... I mean, that's build power that can't be used. I mean, when Ivory King and Fred are already behind, that's half their economy, too. Ivory King has only 3 metal and energy coming in.
Those so, AA bots could be camping that air factory now.
And I think they're trying to do so, but they're actually not close enough. Then they get a little bit paranoid. Now, a Jack coming in here, this is going to be the major problem.
He should
problem.
Be preventing that bomber, those bombers from reloading because they'll just bomb the Jack.
And it looks like that's exactly what's happening. I mean, Ivory King going for a bit of a last-ditch effort, but I think it's going to work getting rid of this air factory. And Zeus coming in, stops the Jack, or at least stuns it out, and down it goes, the factory not being destroyed in the process. Valiant effort, though, and damaged a fair amount of the economy, but not enough. Did not get rid of the factory. Now, at this point, GBC is going
dead
for a large number of puppies. Yeah, well, largely. Though it looks like Ivory King just trying to compensate for that by going for puppies and then maybe trying to take Commander Reclaim? Turn that into more puppies? I don't know. It's a risky strategy. This is basically a matter of, let's see if we can get one last ditch hit in. Maybe, just maybe, we can deal a bit of damage.
I think they should have taken more advantage of the vulnerability of the air in the small map.
That and they probably should have also taken advantage of the fact that they were distracting the North players when they were attacking with the Jack. They could have expanded. I mean, they expanded a little bit. Fred did, but Ivory King hasn't. Ivory King could have expanded over to the north, to the southwest. They are right now.
That's a good rate.
But
going
they could have
on,
done
huh?
it 2 minutes ago. Yeah, that's not bad. Fred coming in with the glaives. That is a nice shot there. And here come the puppies. This is what I was talking about. The puppies are dealing a bit of damage.
Trading puppies for defenders is not really.
No, not particularly good. I mean, puppies are cheaper than defenders.
Now we get
even
to the
however,
awesome
this is a nice
shadows.
Raid.
Yeah, that's good to.
That well is a good 4 metal taken down.
He's very inactive with those anti-air bots. You should have those hotkeyed and move them all the time. Just anticipate and mimic all the movement of the enemy aircraft.
Yeah, split into two groups too, from the looks of it, because it doesn't seem like the bombers are likely to go.
They need
area.
A lot of Rokos to stop this assault of Zeus and Warrior.
And they have none. The Glaive trying to come in here. The Glaives will be okay against the Zeus, so the Warrior is going to take them out. And they are clumping up as well. I mean, Fred has a small chance if they don't clump up the Glaives. They can make them in a really wide spread out line. Really wide spread out circle, really. If they do that in assault, that will maybe work.
Well, what Manu is doing is pretty nice. He is not attacking the main base directly. He wants to take out that left corner first. I'm not sure if this is a wise decision, but
it's fine. I mean, the only downside of this decision is that there isn't much in the west side of the map, but the upside is that there's not a whole lot defending this side either. There's one defender in the main base.
Their entire army is in the left corner now. If they had a counterattack, then... But now they have Rokko, but there's
no... Yeah, if GBC had a counterattack, they would, but the only thing they have right now is the height advantage, which is nice. That is going to last for a decent amount of time, and Stardust trying to be built up. Still not going to be built up in time, though, and the Rokko's able to take advantage of the hype for not particularly long.
They should do a massive counterattack with those glaives now.
Yeah, well, this, unfortunately, I mean, the glaives attacking would have been perfect if they hadn't died. Or, well, they haven't died, actually. They're still out there, but trying to go for, okay, now, once the warrior has gone down, the glaives coming in. Nice timing on that one, but even then, I don't think the glaives would have been better used as an assault force. Fred's commander about to go down, and that's going to take out most of this base. All of the base, actually. That was particularly damaging, and that was a support comm, too. There was no way for it to get out of there. The Zeus is going down, but That was a huge blow. I mean, GBC has no economy at this point. And the north side, they're just taking it. I mean, they have their bombers up. They have shield bots. Julian got shield bots, so it's not like they need to worry about bombers anymore. They can harass wherever they want. And those glaives, they had a nice counterattack angle too, as you were mentioning, along the right side of the map. There wasn't anything in the way, but now there is.
Yeah, a little bit more coordination, a little bit more active movement with those Rokos could have maybe helped them stop that attack.
That certainly would have been helpful. Unfortunately,
all the moves were correct, but the execution was a bit lacking.
Well, the timing was certainly out, and Gremlins running out of energy, just trying to find some position to go into, but they cannot remain cloaked.
It's a flamethrower commander at level 2. Wow.
Yeah, that is unusual. You normally don't see that. With Longer and Napalm, too, that is a specialized flamethrower commander. Normally, it's, well, beam laser or the light particle beam. Flamethrower was useful against the glaives, but that was a hard read. I mean, there was no way that Manu could have easily known that they were going to go for... Well, especially once they got Zeus coming in, they were continuing to go for glaives. And puppies as well. I mean, that sort of light force is... I mean, it comes up in early game, but on a level 2 commander, that's not early game considerations.
No. I think it's just something he played around with and he just picked that commander. I don't think probably there's anything to it.
Yeah, that usually it doesn't. It's very difficult to make strategic decisions based on your commander.
The only exceptions are those level, the small map rushes, where you morph to level 1 and push with the commander.
That is true.
That's a lot of puppies, and they killed Zeus's.
Really inefficiently, actually. I mean, except for the eating afterwards. That sort of helps. Actually, you should point out that the Ivory King's commander has not been taken yet. It hasn't been reclaimed at all, and the puppies are going to take it over on the east side of the map, so at least Ivory King is a little bit of free puppy action going on. At least in theory. Unfortunately,
Bandits are
coming
doing
in,
pretty well, actually. That's nice.
Yeah, over the west side of the map, the Rock is taking good advantage of the choke points. Unfortunately, the Scythe is taking good advantage of its own cloaking to be able to get in range, thus destroying the Rockos. Thus ended the Rockos.
And that's GG.
Pretty much. Ivory King going for one last desperation play with the puppies. Gonna see if they can reclaim as much as they can, but that's not going to work. They can't reclaim. They got most of the commander, though.
Oh, you cannot win the game with puppies alone.
Nope. One shot. I'm kind of glad to see puppies being used more, though. It's one of those things that jump bot players don't often do, is remember to build puppies, because puppies are useful.
They're awesome.
Puppies actually kill things. They just
die
in the process.
Yeah, they're super effective against all little raiders like glaives.
Yes, very effective against raiders.
And they also are good against warriors, and they're good against anything with which is quite expensive and has that much hit points.
Yeah, although that's... Well, the Cloaking Bot Factory, that's quite a few things.
Yeah,
that's a lot of things, actually. Sharpshooters, especially. Sharpshooters being a very notable example. But this is game. Manu and Julian coming in. I don't know why they haven't just caused a GG. Time is hip up for a Pyro. Are you kidding? Okay, just to point out, Fred and the GBC side knows there is a massive assault force coming in. They know that there's warriors coming in. They don't know about the size. Well, they do now, but they didn't. So this, that is not something that should be a surprise to them. And yes, they are self-destructing. Well, Fred is self-destructing. Ivory King has now thrown the GG in, and this will be game as soon as Fred dies. How does Ivory King have... Okay, this is
There we go. GG!
There we go. That was a bit of a long drawn out GG there. I'm a bit surprised they didn't just surrender, as you're typically want to do. But anyway, so that was that. A good demonstration of why it's important to know what your opponent's up to. And also to be mindful of where your opponent could be and, take advantage of that. That movement thing you're mentioning, that is so true. The Gremlins were just out in the east side of the map, not doing anything for a couple minutes.
Yeah, you have 5 or 6 of them, you need to use them, otherwise it's a wasted investment.
Yeah, especially given that the north side had switched over very quickly, or the Mean Machine side, actually. They had switched over very quickly to ground forces. Very strong ground forces, too.
And they managed to expand.
Yeah, well, the entire time. I mean, that's the thing I mentioned before, is against air, you want to expand, and GBC was not doing that.
Okay, map 2.
Map 2 is not yet chosen. It is up to the GBC players to figure out what they want to play on. Knowing them, they probably want to play in Comet Catcher, but we'll see. Everyone knows how much I enjoy that map.
And yeah, it's an awesome map.
So, from here, I mean, we have these players playing. I think there is another game going on. Is there? Please tell me there is. Yes, there is a game going on. It is going to be... Let's double check. Refreshing, I think... Okay, so Skazi has not shown up. Flipstep has not shown up as far as I know.
He's here. Flipstep is here.
Oh, wonderful. Okay, never mind. Like I said, as far as I know. I was wrong, though, and Flipstep is... Wait, where's Flipstep? Oh, yeah, Flipstep is here. For some reason, it's not alphabetical. Anyway, that's beside the point. The point is we're going to Geyser Plains. Okay, right, of course. Yeah, Anarchid pointing out. Probably Geyser. Yes, it is probably Geyser. It is actually Geyser. Good
because
call, Anarchid. Yes, because it's Ivory King. I mean, Ivory King plays 1v2 on Geyser Plains. If they have to.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember that.
No.
Like a year ago. Okay, I think the year ago, the very first 2v2 tournament, Fred had to go and Ivory King was left alone in the bronze match. Ended up playing 1v2 on Geyser Plains and actually didn't do a terrible job. They actually held up pretty well.
Ivory King is a good player.
I mean, they had two commanders too, so it wasn't completely uneven. It was just a little bit difficult. And what the heck? It didn't mark their win.
It does over here.
Okay, that's weird. Why didn't it mark the... Oh! Oh, shoot. Okay, I've got to talk to Liko about this. There's... No, the win counter is default. What the heck's going on? Never mind. I don't know why it didn't mark the win. Hang on a sec. Anyway. Yeah, sorry. I know, it's kind of annoying, but... It's important to have the win counter. Despite how unstable they can be sometimes. So, hopefully they don't start the game too soon. Anyway, yeah, we're gonna... So I don't know who's playing. I think it's Ralhop, Killer, Princey, Clone, I think is the one that's going on right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and... Encounter is... Oh, wrong one. Ah, okay, why did I not mark their wins? What the heck? So Fred and Ivory King are down 1-0. Okay, so yeah, it's... Oh, both flips of Norm... Okay, so everything but the game with Skazi. Yogg-Sothoth, Skazi, and Kane and Hokomoko, that game is the only one not going on right now.
Okay, cool.
So we're back in the game, and for some ungodly reason, this damn thing is not marking marking the wins, despite me changing it manually. I've really got to do this set. If there was a chili set box widget, I could actually do this, but there isn't, so I don't know how to do it. Anyway, Ivory King and Fred over on the east side of the map. Fred going for Clokey. Ivory King hasn't decided yet.
Tanks.
What?
Tanks.
Oh, yeah, tanks. Right, sorry, I thought I did something
thanking
for you.
Thanking you. No, that's... It's...
What? For what? What did I do?
Okay, I see air again.
Air, yep. Julian once again going for air. Manu going for light vehicles. Pretty sensible strategy on this map.
I see windmills. That's funny. And I see shadows.
Why windmills? I mean, it's working out okay right now. It's +2, but it's not going to work out forever.
No, you can... To start out with a windmill can be... Okay.
Well, in this case, it paid off. I mean, that's...
No, not if you lose them like this.
Oh, yeah,
but windmills
that's true.
Kill darts, in case you didn't know.
Oh, yeah, I mean, everything kills darts. The Metal Extractor explosion here is going to kill the dart, although it never happened. But it would have. It'll kill the dart.
It's actually a good trade, a windmill for
right,
a dart.
Smoke signals, I'm turning it off.
Now, let's see if they can use those AA bots a bit more effectively.
Well, we have...
Well, but you cannot raid with Shadows.
Three so far. Kodachi coming in instead of... Well, at least this time is working a little bit more proactively.
Because Shadows are anti-raider units.
Sorry, I wasn't in the main queue. Yeah, sorry about that, guys. Sorry for the viewers. I forgot to switch over to the game itself. Technical issues have been distracting me. Anyway.
And here you can see how the Shadows shut down all raider on your side of the map. You cannot attack anymore if early game if there are Shadows around.
My team count 3? What the hell?
Are you in the game?
Yeah, I'm in the game. Sorry, I just realized that something went weird with the settings for the win counter. I don't know. Anyway, that's beside the point. We'll get that sorted later. Manu and Julian are... See, right now they are once again expanding pretty heavily. Julian... Or sorry, Manu taking the north, Julian not really expanding too much. Surprisingly, because Julian could take the south if they had something forward. They had a crane or... I mean, it's not terribly surprising, but still... The south not being taken, though, that being the juiciest area of the map. A little bit odd, but yeah.
Rose, there are 3 Shadows, so he doesn't need to make any more aircraft now?
No, probably should switch over to...
full map control with 4 bombers, so 3 would have been enough.
Well, at this point, the main thing they need to do is take advantage of that to get the economy. The south side of the map has not been taken. The north side is being taken, which isn't a bad thing to have, but it's still the weakest part of the north side being taken. Plus 0.7, there's not much there.
Julian could help... Manu's lab, or move out with that commander. He has enough build power and aircraft for the moment.
Yeah, well, it's support comm too, so it's 12 build power to start out. And Manu, however, is moving out. I mean, the support commander, it makes perfect sense to do so. Ivory King and Fred, on the other hand, they are staying home. Fred is switching over to ground forces. Light on the glaives so far, but they are still, they are producing them pretty much exclusively.
It's incredibly hard to play against, Shadows like this. If you don't have your own air, it's almost impossible to stop them.
Yeah, because you need to have your anti-air just everywhere. I'm a little bit surprised. I mean, the 5 gremlins is definitely good, but I'm a little bit surprised that Manu and Julian aren't trying to bait it out. They aren't trying to set themselves up so that they decloak the gremlins by putting the bombers too close to them, and then to get other forces to come in, like Scorchers. Just come in and tear it apart. And it looks like
here they
there
go.
Is going to be an attack on that Reaper, which is going to be pretty costly, I think. Going to lose one bomber at least.
Yeah, one, they lost the bomber. They lost
two?
That bomber.
No,
two,
just one.
No, one. Just one bomber.
But still, for half a Reaper.
No,
I mean,
not
that
even.
Does push it back.
Was just going to get repaired. So it was a bit of a miscalculation. I thought they would go for the commander.
Yeah, me too. Because Reapers take about 8 bombers to kill. Or sorry, 9 bombers. They take 9 bombers to kill. So it would have been 3 runs before it finally died. The only thing is, it does buy them a little bit of time. I mean, the Reaper had to pull back. That's something. But still, I don't really understand what the motivation was behind that particular attack. Maybe they didn't... I mean, they should know the commanders... They know the commanders are there. They have it on their radar. Check their view specifically. They know where the commanders are. They know what to attack.
Now I can see a Reaper versus Slasher, and Reaper doesn't care about Slasher.
No, but thankfully the Slashers are not being completely targeted. One of the Slashers is able to get some shots in, but even then, that only took out maybe not even 1,000 health. Out of 7,000. So that Reaper is in a good spot, and Ivory King raiding out the Kodachis, raiding out with the Reapers, and keeping the Gremlins nearby. I mean, the one thing is, Ivory King and Fred, you're right, they can't really move out too much, but Fred is taking the entire north side of the map.
Oh, that's a nice raid on the left. Top left.
Oh. Yo, yeah, so it is. Wow, that's... Fred is taking the north side, pretty
Julian
much.
Julian is not reacting with his bombers. He wants to bomb the Reaper instead.
No, and Julian... Why are they trying to bomb the Reaper? I mean, I realize it's powerful, but Manu has it. Manu's commander has it. The north side is, however, quite vulnerable, and the Glaives coming in here, running straight into the Slashers to no avail. So, unfortunately, Fred, a bit of a miscalculation on their part, and that was surprising, because they know where the Slashers are. I don't know why they ran their Glaives right into them. A little bit of an odd move there. Ivory King, however, forced to push back. The Slashers are nicely asserting map control. Unfortunately for the Mean Machine side, they haven't really taken a lot of economy. While Fred has taken the entire north side of the map, Ivory King is expanding as best they can into the center. And Manu and Julian not... I mean, Manu has a bit of the north. They're taking a fair amount of the north, but Julian, they could take the south if they had the resources to do so. Or if they had a crane, for example.
I really don't like this... Kodachi raid, because this is what's going to happen.
Not much.
It gets bombed instantly. You cannot do this with Gouda cheese.
No, that's... I mean, the Reaper can get away with it. The Reaper isn't going to get killed very easily, but the Kodachis, everything else, not just Kodachis, everything short of Goliaths and Reapers is going to get killed basically in one shot.
As per usual, your best move is to spam defenders. And that's what they're doing, yeah. But they could do it even more.
Yeah, they could push forward with that. I mean, they could probably go to the center and that, like, with this, go near the center, and then that way they could at least get something in that they would... I mean, it would be problematic with the Slashers. That's the one thing. And the Wolverines are trying to get rid of the defenders.
Oh, there's one.
Bomber's coming in as well. Bomber's coming to get rid of the commander. Ivory King's commander is down. Ivory King just lost their commander, but...
Three bombers.
Wow, that is an extremely costly snipe. I don't know if that was even worth it.
That was totally worth it, I think.
Yeah, I guess that's the point. I mean, that does even out the
economy.
It
removes all the build power from the center, and...
And the economy
is... Removes four income. Yeah.
So that does help a lot. However, Julian still surprised.
I don't
still
think you need the bombers to bomb the center. They have the artillery. They're pushing them back slowly. That's nice. You can use the bombers to
take the north.
Bomb the flanks.
Yeah, this entire north side is open. Manu isn't taking it, though, but that's open. It could be taken at a whim.
Now we get that same Kodachi that is going to get bombed, if Julian pays attention.
And it looks like... Where is that Kodachi now?
Top.
Yes. Although it looks like this time around, no, it's not actually. He's able to get away with that.
No, Julian is not reacting.
Julian hasn't really been paying attention to the north at all this game. I mean, they've been paying attention to their main base. They've been sort of paying attention to the south. Sort of. A little bit. Maybe. Not really the north, though. And Glaive's coming in here. Kodachi is now going to go down with a few Glaives following along with that death, but still, it's...
Yeah.
Still half the Glaive's alive. And the Gremlins coming in, able to get rid of one of the bombers.
Yeah, the five Gremlins. Fairly good. I mean, almost, yeah, they took it down.
They are now, I mean, we gotta say, the GBC team is now taking advantage of their Gremlins. They are moving them around.
Yes.
They're putting them where they need to be. It's easier on this map a bit than Iced Coffee, but honestly, not by much. This map is pretty much equally flat.
They're wasting so much metal at the moment. They need nano turrets, constructors, or whatnot.
Yeah, there's the commander, there's the Kodachi, there's... Everything up here.
But it's good. It's a good game so far.
And Manu is...
Nobody's
like
attempted to take the South Maxis yet. It's also interesting.
That's the weirdest thing. That's what I mean. Julian could totally take that. If they built a crane... I mean, they're building shield bots, so they could build a convict from there. But if they built a crane, they could have taken that south side a long time ago and had very little in the way. I mean, right now, GBC and... No, GBC's not aware of this. GBC has no radar coverage at the south side of the map.
And we can see another bomber raid on the commander.
And another... No, another commander attack. Did that kill? Yeah, it did. Yeah, Fred lost our commander too. So that is two commanders down for the GBC side, and Manu and Julian remain with their commanders alive. Both of them. Mind you, Julian really needs that. Julian has no constructors.
They just didn't have enough defenders. They should have built more defenders.
Yeah, I know, right? It's like there's one thing you could do in this game is build more defenders.
Yeah, well, that's been like this since 1996. Seven.
Fair enough. Since a year, since Total Annihilation was in beta.
Exactly. Hey,
however,
now we see another big anti-air truck, but that one is going to get bumped.
Oh, the Copperhead? Yeah, that's not going to matter.
Yep.
I mean, the Reaper barely matters, and at this point, Manu and Julian pushing the center quite nicely. It looks like Ivory King thinks this is game. I don't know, if they take the south, I think they have a good chance. They're still reclaiming decently well. They just haven't really been going for the right type counters. And they haven't really been pushing where they need to. They haven't been assaulting the north as much as they could be. It's mostly the fact that they haven't... I mean, they just now got Hawks. They just now have air control to an extent. I mean, Fred has air control. Julian has bombers, but no air control. Nothing besides those bombers. But surprisingly, neither player on the GBC side is trying to push out too much. They still have the north, though. That has been uncontested. And Ivory King going for the south. There we go. Now we're getting a bit of an interesting thing going on here. Ivory King taking the south. Plus four
take
metal
the
on this.
And retreat and just see how long you can keep it.
Yeah, because if that works out, that'll actually be very helpful.
Despite they don't have commanders, they're ahead in economy.
Yeah, because the one thing, though, is Ivory King is trying to go for heavy tanks without having a particularly strong economy. Like, it's really hard to go for heavy tanks, especially a Reaper heavy strategy, if you don't have plus 20 or plus 30 metal. And Ivory King with plus 11?
Here come the bombers.
That is difficult. And yeah, there they are. The south side of the map, getting rid of that welder. Spotting out the... I mean, they knew. Manu and Julian already knew.
Of course. Oh.
But still, that is... That is not a complete play, though. There's still that plus four. That being said, though, it looks like this is, in fact, going to be a game. Manu coming in with the Ravagers. I don't see any easy way out of this.
Oh, he could lose his commander now.
That's true. The Reapers are actually doing a number on the commander. Manu's commander going up to level three, trying to burn down the Reapers. Unfortunately, not quite as effective as it was against everything that went on in the first game. I mean, against the Glaives and Puppies in the first game. The Reapers are considerably tougher. The Flamethrower, however, is at least helping. As is the slow, but unfortunately that is still...
One dead commander.
Pretty much game. Yeah, got rid of the commander. Burned a bit of the thugs, but still Ivory King and Fred being pushed back heavily.
Yeah, but now they have the... Indeed, they have the air control. Now it's Fred's turn to make bombers.
Is Fred going to do that, though? I mean, they have the Phoenixes. They don't have any Ravens. And against the forces coming in here, I'd say that Ravens are probably the better option against the Thugs. However, Felons are a terrible option against Reapers due to the fact that they have to waste all of their shields just
and
to damage
burn.
Them. Yeah, that Felon, that Thug ball is not going to work. There is no way for that to work.
Well,
the Napalm Bomber coming in here, is it going to work? Yes, it is! Wow, it actually managed to get through after a few hits.
Yeah.
And the convicts on fire, forcing everything further back and making it easier and easier for Fred and Ivory to take that reclaim field near the center, but on their side. If they can take that, that is going to be pretty big.
I think...
The men are coming in here with
Slash. They with their own shadows, or what are they called?
Ravens, yes, definitely. Ravens. And Fred is going for those. They are going to get five Ravens after this particular Phoenix.
Two Phoenixes.
Yeah, I mean, they could, yeah. I mean, the Wolverine, for Wolverine mind clearing, Phoenixes work wonders. So I can totally see why they're going for that. But even with that, it's hard to know where to hit those. And the Glaives are doing a fine enough job. So the main
But now we can see how the Phoenix is supposed to work. It's the anti-raider bomber.
Yes, it is.
Anti-small units.
Unfortunately, that raid is still way too powerful. Fred, losing what little economy they have, this will go down now. The bandits will be burned up. But still, that's a lot.
They have constructors plenty, so
they do.
Take a
rebuild. So there's a lot of reclaim for Fred. Ivory King, however, is quite behind. They look like they're pulling off from Fred's economy, though. So at least they have that to work from. But now Fred, all they really have is reclaim.
They need a way to get through those shields. There are two Felons.
What they have right
but
now...
Not,
I mean,
there's not that much shield power, only three thugs.
Yeah, the sharpshooters would be nice. Ravens would be perfect. From the tank side, banishers would actually be a great idea. I'm surprised banishers have not been built.
Banishers, no.
Well, it would have splash damage. I mean, it would disrupt more than damage, but still, splash damage. And anti-raider power if necessary, but splash damage is the main reason. Getting through those shields. Or Anderkid points out a pillager. A pillager wouldn't be a bad idea either, actually. Although pillagers are kind of hard to hit accurately with, but against the Felons, yeah, that could be totally work.
Nah, it's way too expensive.
Let's see, pillagers are... Oh yeah, 700.
Resources to do this.
Well, they barely have...
Nice napalm.
The Reapers are more expensive than pillagers.
Are we talking about the same unit?
Yeah, the pillager, the heavy tank artillery.
Wait. No, that's Tremor.
You're thinking of Tremor. Tremor is more expensive, and that would be actually...
The pillager is nice. You can park him in your own base and shoot.
But I think this is it. This is looks like the final push coming in here from Julian
and
Manu.
Oh no, it wasn't. There were no ticks.
No, that would have been another really good option too. That's true. Very true. With Glukabot Factory. Actually, I'm surprised. Why didn't they go for ticks? That would have been a wonderful option.
Yeah.
Take the whole thing out, kill them, reclaim them.
To.
Exactly. There's only one place they can go. Set up the ticks and then attack. I mean, they have Zeus coming in here, so they have the right idea of paralysis, but... Yeah, if they had managed to do that, they would have taken out the entire army. And it's not like Manu and Julian have that much of an economic advantage, so that would have been pretty nice. I mean, from there, it would have just been attacking directly with the Reapers, and I guess attacking in, well, center, really. Trying to smash that all up.
It's too bad this is going... I think they cannot come back anymore. There's too much reclaim. They were doing well because of the reclaim, but now they've lost that.
Yeah, it looks like this way. We're going to have... No, the final push. with nothing really getting in the way. I think Fred is kind of distracted. They're just trying, they're autopiloting at this point. And they're trying to build whatever seems best straightforwardly from damage, but they can't really do much. I mean, the Reapers to drain the Felon shields and Ticks would have been great too. Or Thunderbirds would be another option too. I mean, Fred could build a couple of those.
Yeah, that's one of the best aircraft against shield bombs.
That's pretty much the best aircraft against shield bombs. But for some reason, Mano and Jillian not confident that they have the military advantage. They have an overwhelming military advantage. They can push in. I'm very surprised that's not happening. They can just go.
Oh, well, if you're winning, you can win more.
There's only so much you can win. If you win, you win. That's it. That's as far as it goes.
No, but you have an advantage. You can increase your advantage by just waiting a bit more.
That's a point, I suppose. Yeah, Anik is saying, they're cloning. Yes, they are definitely cloning. Because this is a clone thing to do, is to just go for... It's just basically hole up, just trying to knock your opponent's base as safely as possible, as risk-free as possible, and then go for it. Because I think at this point, Mano and Jillian know the extent of the GBC forces. They have radar coverage and everything. They know exactly what's going on. The Felon, I think, is the only weakness, because the fact that they have to deal with the Reapers, and the Reapers take up a lot of the shields. In fact, all the shields.
They just killed three Zeus's?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, the Ravagers are taking that out. And now at this point, the Reapers are down. Ivory King throws in the towel. Fred, we'll see if they follow suit.
I would have liked to see more of GBC.
But that, unfortunately, is going to be the game. And that is going to be the match. And that is going to be GBC. Well, Fred and Ivory King knocked out of the tournament. There may be other GBC players. I don't think so. So that is... Well, that is that. And Prince Reaper and Clone did win in round two there into semifinals. Flipstep Norm Akram Sprung was being... That was being played. I don't know about the one between Skazi Yogstoth and Kane. I have no idea what's going on there. None at all. I honestly don't know. I think Skazi... Well, Skazi has been replaced, so I don't know what's going on. Skazi, I don't see them anywhere.
Let me check.
Okay, Flipstep Norm also won. So I might just do Flipstep Norm, Prince Reaper, Clone semifinals. Get to that right now. And then, I don't even know if Skazi is playing. I don't know. But it looks like Prince Reaper, Clone is the way to go. Where are they anyway? Oh, they're in the next game over. So at this point, it looks like it's going to be fairly nice semifinals from at least the top bracket. The bottom bracket, I don't know. I think Yogstoth is just going to get knocked out just for lack of a teammate. Oh, no. Sorry. It's Yogg and Drone. Drone took Skazi's place that hasn't been updated in the brackets yet. There it is. Okay, there we go. So yeah, Yogstoth, Drone versus Kane Hokomoko, I think. Is that going on? I don't see it happening, so it looks like that has not started. Oh yeah, actually it's... Is it starting? I mean, Kane and Hokomoko are here. So anyway, looks like that is going to be the next game. And then... We will have the semifinals after that. We'll be back once that is starting up, so stay tuned.